Good morning and welcome to the beginning of another week. Here we are together for just a little while to have our hearts and our minds filled and fueled with the Word of God. And so I hope you're ready. Hope you're prepared as we jump in now to Acts chapter 16. We're going to look at verses 1 through 5 in our digital devotional time together this morning. And so I invite you to join me as we open with a word of prayer and ask the Lord's help as we seek to study and understand and apply His Word. So let's pray. Oh God, we give You thanks and praise for this day, and we do pray that You would grant us clarity of understanding, clarity of interpretation, and clarity, God, of application to our life, relevance to our life, and influence in our life to grow in Jesus and to go in Jesus as ambassadors with the message of salvation. I pray, Lord, now that You'd speak and minister to our minds and hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. So Acts chapter 16, and this is how the word goes. Paul came also to Derbe and to Lystra. A disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek. He was well spoken of by the brothers at Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted Timothy to accompany him, so he took him and circumcised him because of the Jews who were in those places, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they went on their way through the cities, they delivered to them for observance the decisions that had been reached by the apostles and elders who were in Jerusalem. So the churches were strengthened in the faith, and they increased in numbers daily. So Paul here again, remember, Paul and Barnabas have parted ways over John Mark. Paul and Silas head through a kind of a land route to retrace their steps, and Barnabas and John Mark go the water route to Cyprus and out that direction. So they're going a different direction. And the idea is, especially for Paul, is he's going to retrace where he has been to strengthen the churches. We see that at the end of chapter 15 when it says he went through Syria and Cilicia strengthening the churches. And he comes to Derbe and Lystra, and there he finds a disciple named Timothy. Likely Paul knows Timothy or has known Timothy because of the last time he was there. I suppose there's also a chance that maybe Timothy has become a believer as those who remained behind after Paul and Barnabas came through and they spread the message of salvation. But we don't really know for sure. I'm inclined to think that Paul is acquainted and understands Timothy because Timothy's mom was a Jewish woman who became a follower of Christ, and likely that happened under the ministry of Paul. But again, I'm filling in a little bit of historical gaps with some conjecture. But we do know that Timothy's mom is a Jewish woman and Timothy's dad is a Greek man. And Paul is recruiting Timothy to be with him and Silas on this missionary journey because he is well-regarded, it says, that he's well-spoken of by the brothers, the believers there in Lystra and Iconium. But what does Paul do? Paul has Timothy circumcised. Now, I don't need to go into what all that is. You probably should know. If you don't, kind of carefully Google that. For the Jews, this was the identifying mark in males that they belonged to God, that they were sons of Abraham, that they were children of the covenant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And what we might be inclined to think here is that Paul making Timothy get circumcised went against, was a contradiction to the Jerusalem Council's decision. After all, why was Timothy circumcised if it was unnecessary for him to follow the law of Moses in order to be a follower of Jesus, to be saved, to be born anew, born again? So why have Timothy circumcised? After all, Paul will even write in Galatians chapter 6, verse 15. He says, "For neither circumcision counts for anything, nor uncircumcision, but only a new creation by faith in Jesus." So what is Paul doing here? Is this a blatant disregard for the council's decision, of which Paul was a major advocate for that decision. And I assert to you, no, Paul is not contradicting the Jerusalem council's decision, which was heavily influenced by Peter and Paul and their testimony. So what is the reason? It's this. Timothy is a Jewish man by birth through his mom. He's a Jewish man, even though he has a Greek father. But as a Jewish man who was uncircumcised, he was prohibited from being in close personal contact or fellowship with other fellow Jews. Paul is an apostle to the Gentiles, but he also seeks to always minister to the Jews there first. And as a Jewish man, Timothy, being uncircumcised, he is barred from, he is hindered from being able to minister the hope and the message of Jesus Christ to fellow Jews. And so this was a function of practicality. It was not a function or an act that Paul encouraged Timothy to go about, that Timothy embraced. This was not something done to earn salvation, to follow the law of Moses. This was purely a practical act on the part of Paul and Timothy so that Timothy would be able to have access to fellow Jews for the sake of preaching and proclaiming the hope and the message of salvation through Jesus Christ as the anointed and long-awaited Messiah. And so Timothy's circumcised so he can gain access to fellow Jews for the gospel. And so that is the whole reason for this. And there are going to be times where we might feel as though a decision we make or someone else makes is a compromise against the gospel. And not everything really is a compromise against the gospel. There's a great book by Ortland it's called Finding the Right Hills to Die On. And it's a book that really, it does what's called theological triage, just like on the battlefield when injured soldiers come forward and a medic goes up and they perform triage. They evaluate cases that are absolutely most important and then gradually less important, and also then the things that are dire to the point of death. And this book on theological triage, Finding the Right Hills to Die On, helps us understand that there are some doctrines, there are some Christian beliefs that are absolutely undeniably essential, and there can be no compromise on them. And actually, the numbers of them are quite small. Here, if we were to do theological triage, finding the right hills to die on, Paul is not having Timothy go through the mark of circumcision as an act of religious commitment. It is an act of cultural identification. It is Timothy saying, I am a fully Jewish man, and thereby I want to be able to be in a relationship, fellowship, connection with you, community with you. But ultimately, Timothy is seeing this as an opportunity to be able to preach the gospel. You know, it's kind of like somebody that maybe doesn't like coffee. Again, coffee and circumcision, I know that it sounds as though I'm mixing such ridiculously different categories, but follow me for a second. Someone who does not like coffee, but they're willing to hang out in coffee shops, maybe even occasionally sip a very highly sweetened cappuccino or something that deadens the taste of the coffee for the sake of being around folks that they might be able to share the good news of Jesus. Now, we hopefully all do this all the time. We don't just hang out where we're comfortable. We don't just talk to people that we like with or agree with, that we are willing to go outside of our comfort zones to be with, to be around, and to be able to speak into the life of others who don't know Jesus. This is part of being an evangelist, part of being an ambassador for Jesus Christ, where we are willing to do that. And in no way is that meaning that you are compromising on your conviction that Jesus Christ is the only way to fellowship with God through his death and resurrection. So Paul, in effect, is affirming and upholding the Jerusalem's council. This is not a religious decision or a religious act. It is a cultural act to be able to enter into relationship. Probably a more relevant example is missionaries that have gone to other cultures and have started to practice particular forms of dress and wearing particular garments, and they might have religious significance to some people, but they do this to be able to embrace aspects of the culture without embracing the aspects of the religious commitment so that they can enter into relationship with these folks to be able to share the hope that is found in Jesus Christ alone. And so Paul does uphold and affirm the Jerusalem Council. And as a matter of fact, it is so significant that he is, that this circumcision is not a compromise of that, that it says Luke, who is the writer of the book of Acts, says in verse 4 that they went on their way throughout the cities and they delivered to them for observance, for behavior, for practice, for embodiment among them, the decisions that have been reached by the apostles and elders. In other words, Paul is still proclaiming and still practicing the reality of the Jerusalem Council, which is this, for summary in chapter 15, people can have access to Jesus Christ as their Savior apart from keeping the law of Moses. A Gentile does not have to become a Jew by observing the law in order to then be in a position to accept the grace of God. It is not by works, but by grace alone. However, then, all followers of Jesus Christ are challenged, are encouraged, are pushed and compelled through the message of the council that as a follower of Jesus, they are to flee and avoid idolatry and immorality. Or as I said on Sunday in my sermon, that the negative is to avoid idolatry and immorality. The positive is to embrace faith in Christ and faithfulness for Christ. And so Paul is, in fact, upholding the message of the Jerusalem Council, which is the gospel of Jesus Christ and the impact it does. So think on that. I encourage you to ponder that, meditate, reflect upon it. And what does it mean to be a follower of Jesus? Maybe pick up that book by Ortlund, Finding the Right Hills to Die On. And that might be a very helpful understanding of some of the things that are important but of lesser important than the things that are of central and foundational importance for us as the people who are followers of Jesus Christ. Well, let's pray and send you off for your day. God, please minister to our hearts and help us to know that it is by faith alone, because of your grace alone, through Christ alone, as proclaimed in Scripture alone, for the glory of God alone, that our lives are redeemed and adopted and held secure in your hands forever. Not by works, not by any act of the flesh or any effort on our part to earn your favor. And yet, God, as you change and transform us and make us new creations through faith in Jesus Christ, you call us to not further earn your grace, but we live in such a way that it is evidence that your grace has saved us. Your grace in the Holy Spirit strengthens us. And your grace is what is sanctifying and readying us for glory. So Lord, help us to be those who live by faith in Jesus, faithfully for Jesus. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. All right. Well, wonderful. Hey, I'll see you again tomorrow, and may the Lord be with you and bless you. And if you would love to talk more about this, this is some good theological stuff. This is some good stuff we're interacting here in the book of Acts, and particularly here, the beginning of chapter 16. I look forward to hearing from you and your comments and feedbacks, maybe your questions. But anyway, the Lord be with you. I'll see you again tomorrow.